So this is good timing for a stats lecture, as always. So today, we're going to talk about a kind of a really complicated, confusing subject about how do you determine the sample size for a study. This is very important, mostly done wrong, by the way, in most papers. Not surprising, but we're going to talk about sample size. This is Dr. Shire's lecture. One of our former residents gave this lecture. This is from a course we taught maybe about 6 years ago on biostats at Downstate Medical Center in the medical school here. So, you know, we're always interested about how big a sample you need, how many patients you need. This is important not only for the statistical integrity of the subject, but also for the feasibility of the subject. If you need 5,000 patients for a study, it's very difficult to do. Certainly a single center study would be impossible and not feasible. And also that goes into the costs, to the amount of material you need to do the study, the time it takes to do the study. So the sample size is one of the things that really determines if you can actually do the study. And if you do it wrong, at the end of the study, you'll find that maybe you didn't see a difference between the two groups, which really you would have done if you had a big enough study. And on the other side, this is what happens if you see studies done in very large studies by pharmaceutical studies will do like 10,000 patients. And why do they do such a large sample size? It has to do with how statistics work, how t-tests work, and Fish's exact test, this idea of frequency statistics, that if you have a large enough sample size, you almost always find the difference between the two groups. It's almost guaranteed. So if you're a drug company that wants to sell a drug, it makes sense to do very, very large samples. Even when the effect size, the difference between the two groups is very small, if you do a large enough sample size, you'll always meet the, you know, bullshit 0.05, and you're published and you get to sell the drug, because we still believe that, some of us. So this is a big problem. So on the one side, if you don't do a large enough sample, you may miss an effect that's really there. And the other side, if you do a tremendous sample, you may see a difference in the two groups. It may be statistically significant, but not clinically significant. Like if you had two groups, drug A and drug B, to drop blood pressure, and the drop in the blood pressure was 5 millimeters of mercury systolic, right? If you did 10,000 samples, you could see the 5 millimeter drop in systolic blood pressure, and it would be, you know, less than 0.05 statistically significant. But that's not clinically important. So that's what drug companies really rely on, these large sample sizes, to really find statistical significance where there probably is not clinical significance. So this is the Pearson-Niemann approach to, let's see if we can do this. So, whoops. So if you think that the null hypothesis, there's no difference between the two groups, right? So the top of the columns is the truth in the universe, right? Which no one really knows, right? But we're going to say there is a truth in the universe. Drug A is greater than drug B, where you could reject the null hypothesis, where the null hypothesis is false, which is the right upper box. And if the statistical test, if the drug finds a difference between the two groups, and there really is a difference between the two groups, that's correct. Or if there's the null hypothesis is true, there really isn't any difference, and the drugs don't find a difference, then that's appropriate, right? So that's the left lower box, which is correct. But then there's a type 1 error. The type 1 error occurs when you find a difference between the two groups, but there really isn't a difference between the two groups. So this is usually a product of bias in the study. We're not going to talk about that today, but this is because the methodology is poor, there was selection bias, there wasn't good concealment, there wasn't good blinding. The study was a terrible study, but it found a difference between the two groups, but in the truth in the universe, there really isn't. But it's the last box we're going to talk about today is the type 2 error. This is where there really is a difference between the two groups, but you didn't get a large enough sample to see the difference. And this is where sample size comes in. And that's what we're going to talk about today, type 2 errors. So when we talk about sample size, we talk about the power of the study. The power of the study is once the study has been done, right? Once the study has been done, how sensitive it is to find the difference between the two groups. When we talk about the risk of a type 2 error, we talk about the beta. 1 minus the beta is the power of the study. So the risk of a type 2 error is beta, and that usually, and of course there is no data to support this, is we accept a 20% error. Where the risk of a type 1 error is alpha, which we use 0.05. Again, no data for that, completely made up. But it, the philosophy behind it is we would rather make the mistake of too small a sample size and missing a difference between the two drugs, 20%, than finding a difference that really doesn't exist, 0.05. Kind of makes sense, right? It kind of makes philosophical sense. It makes clinical sense too. You would rather miss a small effect than overestimate a larger effect, inappropriately overestimating because of bias in the study. So that's the reason of 0.05. But we're going to talk about power of the study. So if the risk that we accept of a type 2 error is 20%, then 1 minus is 80% power. So when we do these calculations, all these websites and all these calculators will ask for the power, and it's 1 minus beta, which is 80%. And then the alpha that they're going to ask for is 0.05, which is the risk of a type 1 error. So when you're interested in making thinking about sample size calculations, the first thing you have to think of is the outcome variable. If the outcome variable is a yes-no, where you determine the frequency, 70% yes, 50% no, right, dead, alive, dichotomous outcomes, that's called frequency or dichotomous variables. And there's one sample size equation for that and one way of thinking about it. But we're going to talk about today where there's interval data. We're going to talk about today the paper, which is a VAS score of itchy, you know, for urticaria. So we're going to talk about, I'm going to spend some time talking about how you look at interval data. So the criteria to look to calculate sample size on interval criteria has to do with the alpha, 0.05 we use, the beta, or the power, which is 80%, right? It has to do with the effect size. This is common to both, and alpha, beta, and effect size are common to both frequency, dichotomous, and interval data. If you, the effect size is the difference between the two groups. That's what you're really interested in. And how do we know the difference between the two groups before we do the experiment? So this is the guesstimate. And this has to do with a lot of statistics. There's a lot of math, and I'm not going to show you the math. I mean, it's just algebra, but I'm not even going to show you that. But you think that because there's all this math involved, there's something concrete about it. And there is, but the first part is a guesstimate. So the first part is you have, before you do the experiment, you have to think how big the two groups are going to be before you do the experiment to figure out the sample size. Now, you can base that on what's a clinically significant difference between the two groups. Or you can do a pilot study, or you could use the medical literature. A lot of people just guess. But it should be somewhere in the method section. Sample size, and I'll show you where it is in this paper, is usually the last paragraph in the method section, which by the time you get through the rest of the methods, you're unconscious and, you know, hardly breathing at all. So you probably have never even got to that part. I like that part, but that's something, that's me. But the sample size has to do with the effect size. So the effect size is a guesstimate based on either your clinical experience, what do you think a clinically important difference between the two groups before you do your study would be, right? And that's how you set up the sample size. So although there's a lot of math in the middle, there's a guesstimate at the beginning. So sample size is always kind of a guesstimate. And then at the end, you fudge the sample size a little bit more because you have to make the sample size bigger than this number, because how many patients am I going to enroll? Because some patients will drop out of the study. Some patients, the data will not be good. Some patients will be inappropriately put into the study. Some patients will not take the drug, right? Patients, subjects, bad, right? We know that. So you always have to increase the fudge factor at the end. So you're kind of making something up at the beginning, doing a lot of math in the middle, and then making something up at the end. So I want to just to tell you that it's not all just math. So for when we do sample size for interval data, there is one other criteria which we need, is the spread of the data. So if you're guessing the effect size, the difference between the two groups, the means, the difference between the two groups, you also have to guess how big a spread of the data will be between the two groups that you've never even studied, right? And the standard deviation, which is the spread of the sample that you get, which you haven't gotten yet, is a big deal, because I'll show you some examples that the standard deviation and the effect size are really the major determinants of the sample size. And those two are guesstimates. And also that you have to remember the other thing about sample size is that 90% of studies never hit the expected sample size. It's just that's how the world is. So there's lots of type 2 errors out there. So that's what I wanted to talk about today, is the sample size. So, and also the other part is, do you do one tail or two tails? So it's the tail has to do with this, you know, the bell curve. So should you do one tail test or two tail test? The idea of a one tail test or a two tail test is that if you give drug A or B, A can either increase the blood pressure more than B or decrease the blood pressure more than B. So it can go either way. So that's a two tail test. A one tail test is you assume that the drug is always going to work. So that's verboten. If any paper ever says we did a one tail test, you should throw the paper out immediately, because one, they don't know anything about statistics. Two, that if you do a one tail test, it's like you've increased 0.05 to 0.1. So you've hit the alpha much easier, because you're only testing one side of the probability curve. So it should always be two-tailed. So those are determinants of interval data, is how many tails you have, the alpha, which you arbitrarily set at 0.05, the beta, which you set at 0.2, and the power then is 80% to tell the difference, right? The effect size is how different the means are gonna be that you hope for, or that you've seen in the literature or done a pilot study, and the spread of the data. The spread of the data can be from a pilot study you've done, it could be from the literature, or just, most of the times, it's just a guess. It's just a guess. So you can see that if you choose the effect size, the bigger the difference in the effect size, the bigger the difference in the means, how do you think that affects sample size? It decreases sample size dramatically. If you check standard deviation, if you make if you assume that the spread of the data that you're going to get from the study is very narrow, again, the sample size will be much smaller. If you accept the larger standard deviation, you'll need a much larger sample size. So what people do, I've done this myself, is you sit there with the calculator and you say, well, what's feasible? Can I do 50 patients, 100 patients, or 3,000 patients? And then you play with the effect size and the standard deviation until you can kind of sample size that you think you can do. And then you somehow contort the sample size section in the methods to come to that number. And this is the truth. Everyone does this. It's not just me. Sharia. No, it's not just Sharia. It's Sharia. No, it's not. So that's really what I wanted to talk about today, is I wanted to talk about what the elements of sample size. For frequency data, you just need the alpha, the beta, and the effect size. So you really don't have to know the baseline number, right? You really don't have to know what the blood pressure should be. All you have to do is say the difference between the two blood pressures, or the difference in the VAS score that we're going to talk about in the paper. You really don't have to, you don't have to guess the outcome, you just have to guess the difference between the two groups. So it's in both the frequency and interval data. You don't have to guess the blood pressure, you don't have to guess the mortality rate, you just have to guess the difference in the mortality rate, or the difference in the blood pressure, which is the effect size. You got it? You got it at home? Are you awake at home?
Yes, we are listening.
Okay, Kevin. I know it's you. You're the only one awake. Ronnie, how do I get to the paper?
I'm here too, Dr. Sinnert.
Yes, 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 yes.
The paper is ready.
You put the paper up here?
Yeah.
Yeah, there's the paper. Great. So I wanted to show you where in the paper the effect size is. Oh my God.
Okay.
I'm glad you're doing this because when I do a Google search, it ends up somewhere else. There you go. So if this paper was to look at urticaria, and it was, there were three groups. One group, it doesn't really matter what the groups are. I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about the paper. There were three groups in the study. And if you go to the method section, which I highlighted here, let's just go to the method section and let's see. Oh, uh-oh, Rodney, what did I do? I broke it.
Let's see where it goes.
There it is. Okay. There you go. It's highlighted. It should be highlighted. Yeah. Oh, see, I highlighted it, so it would be easy for you to find. If you go to the place that has a lot of yellow, because it's early in the morning, I figured yellow you could find, it talks about sample size. So there are three groups. So they actually did something in this study that they didn't even give them credit for. So they used an alpha of 0.05 and a power of 80%. And they looked at VAS scores to how itchy you were, right? There was some scoring system. You would hope that if the paper was done well, which I thought this paper was pretty good, they actually used a validated scoring system for urticaria to give these three groups. One gave some antihistamine and some dexamethasone, and then dexamethasone and prednisone was the third group. It doesn't matter what the groups are. They chose the VAS as their outcome variable. So VAS is interval data because the difference between 1 and 2 is the same between 7 and 8 and between 9 and 10. So it's interval data, right? So they chose a difference of 2 points. If the urticaria, if the itching decreased by 2 points, then that was a clinically significant difference. That was the effect size that they chose. And they actually found the paper to give them some credibility that this wasn't just a guesstimate. And then they chose the standard deviation. Remember, in interval data, you have to look at the alpha, the beta, which they did, the effect size, 2, and the standard deviation was 2.1. You see that in there? 2.1. So if they put all this, then they found some computer program, any computer program will do. I'll show you one of them. I gave a URL, and I'm going to show you how to put the data in. There's lots of online statistical programs. There's not one that's better than the other. It doesn't really matter because it's pretty imprecise how you chose it. But this paper was pretty good, is that they gave some references for what is a clinically significant effect size on this scale. This scale has been validated at least once, which is good. And the standard deviation, they gave some reference for that. So this is pretty good. This is pretty good. They compared three groups, right? So they compared the A to B, B to C, and A to C. So it's three comparisons. So when you do that, they actually took one step further that they didn't give themselves credit for, which is they have to correct for the type 1 error. Because remember we said the probability of a type 1 error is finding a difference when none exists, and we use 0.05, so 95% sensitive to find the difference, the real difference between the two groups, if there's no bias. But that's only when you compare two groups, A and B. When you compare three groups, and there are then three comparisons, right? If you compare two groups, there's only one comparison. But if you compare three groups, there's A and B, B and C, and A and C, right? You have to correct the 0.05, called the Bonferroni correction. Now I'm way off tangent, and I've lost most of you. But you have to divide 0.05 by 3, which is 0.17. 0.017. Let's stay awake, stay conscious. And so they actually corrected for that when they put in the sample size analysis. And the reason is I back calculated and I made sure they did that, which they didn't even give themselves credit for. They should have given themselves credit for that. But they didn't, but they got it right. I was surprised that they got it right and they didn't say they did it, which is surprising. But they did it. So, and they came up with a sample size of, what was it, 69 participants needed, 23 in each group, right? So they, because they're 3 times 23 is 69, right? So they came up with 23 patient subjects in each group, which was feasible. It's easy to do, right? Luckily for them, 69 patients is not a big thing to do. Even we could do 69 patients with urticaria, right? And that's how they did it. Can I get the website? Yeah.
So I know that score is validated, but I don't know. So they say, if you see the 2.4 in alpha measurement,
yeah,
like they define the meaningful change in the VAS score of greater than 2 points.
Right.
And a lot of that will based off what they say, like the high investigators, like stigma.
Right.
So that's like part of like.
That is always what happens. Is the effect size is always a guess. And so you can play with the effect size. You know, we do that all the time when we plan studies. Is we, since it's a guesstimate, we might as well use it to our advantage, right? So this is the soft part of the statistics. Remember I said, at the beginning, there's a lot of guessing. At the middle, there's a lot of math. And at the end, there's a lot of guessing. So, you know, when we talk about this, the math is good and statistics are good. But at the really heart of statistics and sample, especially sample size analysis, there's a lot of guessing going on. So you have to take it with a grain of salt that they planned the effect size of 2 so that we'd get a sample that was feasible. If you had an effect size of 1, you know, it'd be like 1,500 patients. Or if you had a standard deviation of 4, you'd need 1,500 patients. And you can play with the numbers yourself. This is there are lots of websites to do sample size. I sent you guys this website because it's my friend, Michael Kahn, from the University of San Francisco. And not to be biased, well, I'm biased about this, I like the guy. This is the best website for sample size. And if you go to this one, which is the mean sample size, and here are the alphas. So he put 0.05 already and 0.2 because he didn't trust you. And if you put the 50% is how the groups are proportioned, because you could make it so one group has a higher sample size than another, and this will tell you how to proportion the patients. Although most people use a balanced sample size of 50% in each group. And then if you choose this, which is the effect size, if you choose this and you say 2, and you choose the standard deviation, which is 2.1, and then you have to change the 0.05. This was the really neat thing about the study. It's a really nerdy thing. Is you put, instead of 0.5, because you're comparing 3 groups, if you put 1.7, and you calculate 0.17. Yes, because it's 3 groups, right? And you go down here. Oops. Yeah, it'll calculate the groups. And you get 23 in each group if you use the second. So that's how they did it. That's exactly how they did it. That's why I figured out the 0.17, because you put in 0.5, it's a different number. So that's sample size. Does anyone have any questions?
So, Rich, in terms of when you're reading the papers, obviously looking to see that they describe that the alpha, the beta, and discussing the paper, obviously that's a good sign. Is there any specific place where they register the sample size that if they say that,
yes,
it's like, okay, you're good?
If we go back to the paper, which I can't find again. Where is the paper? Now it's lost in the world. Okay. There's the paper. If you go to the paper, this paper is registered because it's an RCT in clinicaltrials.gov. Usually it says it at the beginning of the method section somewhere. Yeah, here. Do you see that under methods? Oops. Oh, now I lost it. But it goes.
And that's what I was kind of getting at. But the idea is that if you see that they registered, somebody's kind of checked them that they did the proper sample.
No, they didn't check them. What they did, the reason that clinicaltrials.gov exist is for sample size. I'm glad you asked that. Is that they count, but when you do clinicaltrials.gov, it puts a date stamp when they accept it and put the method section in like in stone. So you can't change it. Once they give you a number, you cannot go back and change the sample size. And it's the methodology. And the reason they did that is because before there were clinicaltrials.gov, they would enter every patient and do a student t-test. And then when they hit 0.05, they would stop the study, which is just not kosher. Not kosher at all. Right? That's like pork and eggs. Not kosher. Not kosher. So the whole idea of clinicaltrials.gov was to stop that one thing where you would enter a patient, because you didn't have to say what the sample size was up front. And then in the method section, you could write the paper and make up the effect size and the standard deviation to get to the sample size you got. In frequency statistics, you have to have a stopping rule. You say, I have to get to this sample and then no more. Because you could see when the sample size is very small, the p-value can change dramatically with adding one or two patients. Can add dramatically if the sample size is very small. So you can play the game where you enter a patient, run back to the computer and say, oh, 0.06. Well, we'll enter another patient, 0.04, stop the study, publish. So that's what that stopped. That's exactly what that stopped. The way to actually then look to see how the sample size affects the p-value is a thing called the fragility index, which I think we've talked about before. But the fragility index says that, so I got a sample of 60 patients in each group, and the mortality rate was significantly different in group A, right? But I hit the sample size. The fragility index says how many patients, instead of dying, would survive to get a non-significant p-value. It's amazing when you do that. When you do that to these big studies, like the NIN study or any study that you want, it says how many patients do you have to take out from one group to put in the other group to make it not statistically significant. It's amazing. It's like two or three patients in the NIN study. Two or three patients who didn't have an MRN1 greater than one in 3 months. If two of those patients didn't make it, it wouldn't be statistically significant. We wouldn't be given TPA, which is very disturbing. So I think this fragility index is how fragile the study is to small changes in allocations of patients, right? And I think that's one of the tests you should think about. And there are fragility index websites too I can send you, that if you just go to the website and put in the numbers, it will tell you how many patients need to be reallocated. Right? And then what is the number that should be to be reallocated? I mean, no one really knows. It's like number needed to treat. No one really knows what the number needed to treat is. But you could have some clinical sense when you talk to your patients and do this thing called shared decision making about whether I'm going to give this drug to the patient. And you can say, you know, how confident are you in the number? Instead of just sticking with an arbitrary number, which is 0.05 and a power of 80%. So what I want to tell you is that, you know, just because you get some statistically significant number, it still doesn't mean it's clinically important, and it doesn't mean that it's very robust in statistical terms, that it's very sensitive to reallocation of one or two patients. If I just did the study a week longer and Ms. Cohen failed, then the study wouldn't be statistically significant. To me, this is not such a big study, but it depends upon the drug and the treatment. If the drug A and drug B have equal adverse side effects and equal complications, and they both show some benefit, then maybe it doesn't matter how fragile it is. But if one drug kills 50% of the patients, the other drug kills none, then I really want to make sure that the really toxic drug has a very big effect size. So I think the whole idea of statistics and a kind of a layman's approach, and we see this on CNN and Peter Navarro, which just pissed me off last week. But you can see politicians quoting, well, it's published in this journal and the p-value was 0.05, so that must be the truth. Well, we've got to be better than that. We have to be better than that for our patients. And we have to dig the next level of statistics that just because you hit the sample size, if you do hit the sample size, that just because you hit 0.05 doesn't mean that this is a truly clinically significant paper. Like that paper I sent out, the Wuhan paper that everyone is quoting. The president quotes this, you know, hydroxychloroquine, decreasing pulmonary whatever, which was a weird outcome, but that's what the primary outcome was. And they didn't even do the chi-square test they said they were going to do in the method section. When I did the chi-square test, it was not significantly significant. It was 0.057. So, and that's what everyone is talking about, hydroxychloroquine. That's what people are giving. The medical service is giving hydroxychloroquine, right, to everybody, right? Based on this paper that's not statistically significant because one group had an 80% difference, the other group had only the placebo group 54%. Well, and they said, well, that's a big difference. Well, it's not a big difference because it's not statistically significant. And the confidence intervals overlap each other dramatically. So maybe we should kind of think about this. So that's what I wanted to impress on you today, is that the whole idea of sample size, although it's grounded in math and a lot of algebra and a lot of statistics, it's based on guesstimates at the beginning and guesstimates at the end. And until you really know what's going on, you have to be careful about what you do for your patients. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Dr. Sinnert.
Oh, you're welcome. Excellent. Angela?